Hello friends, welcome to Science Land. I am Nikita. Today I'm going to discuss malaria. It is a parasitic disease. Let's start with the introduction of malaria. The causative agent of malaria is Plasmodium species, which is a protozoa, Plasmodium vivax, and there is another example which is Plasmodium falciparum. Plasmodium falciparum is the most virulent protozoa. The presence of vector becomes very important in transmitting the protozoa to human body. So the vector is female anopheles mosquito. Females feed on blood, but males do not. Males usually feed on plant juices. 50% of the world population live in malarial endemic area. 10% of the world population is always infected with low levels of Plasmodium in their blood. What makes it number one death-causing disease? There are two main reasons. The first is multiple drug resistance in Plasmodium species, and the second is pesticide resistance of Anopheles mosquito. So these are the two main reasons why it is causing so many deaths annually. Okay, so let's start with the life cycle of Plasmodium species. Let's assume we have a human being and a mosquito which is carrying the Plasmodium is feeding on his blood. The mosquito, while it is sucking the blood, it will release sporozoids. Now, what are sporozoids? These are long, slender cells which are covered by an antigen, which is known as CS antigen. It is a 45 kilodalton protein, which is known as circumsporozoid antigen. Circum as in the entire cell is covered with that antigen. Now, why this antigen? Because this CS antigen mediates adhesion with hepatocytes. So the sporozoids are released in the blood. From blood, within 30 minutes, they travel to the liver. We have hepatocytes as liver cells. Now these sporozoids multiply in the hepatocytes. The hepatocyte becomes a multinucleate cell, which is known as schizont. After multiplication is done, the hepatocyte ruptures and it releases merazoids. So these are individual merazoids which are blue in color. These merazoids will come out of the liver and again will be flowing in the blood. In the blood we have RBCs. It will be infecting those RBCs, multiplying in the RBCs, and RBCs will be further rupturing, releasing more merazoids. So there is successive stages of merazoids. The first stage is here, wherein it is released from the ruptured hepatocyte. The second stage is here, where it is released from ruptured RBC. Now, few merazoids, they differentiate into male and the female gametocytes and they flow in the blood. So the other remaining merazoids will be there in the body and they will cause symptoms and will carry forward the disease. Let's assume the other day another mosquito comes which is not infected. While sucking the blood, it will also take the gametocytes. Now, the gametocytes will be in the mosquito's gut where both the gametes will fuse. They will form zygote. They will multiply, they will differentiate, and further, they will be ready to be released through the salivary gland, and from salivary gland sporocytes are again released and the same mosquito becomes infected. So this is the life cycle of Plasmodium. So let's talk about symptoms of the disease. We have recurrent chills, fever, and sweating every 48 hours. Every time a successive new generation of merazoids are released, you have these symptoms. Apart from it, the RBCs are infected and they are ruptured. So anemia and weakness. There is also cerebral malaria. This is due to the merazoids blocking the capillaries. If the capillaries are blocked, you have intense headache, renal failure, heart failure, and cerebral damages there. So that is the extreme symptom of the disease. Talking about immunology. So there was a cancer patient in which the recombinant TNF alpha was injected and his symptoms were similar to malaria, very strangely. So the hypothesis was made that maybe in patients with malaria, the excessive release of cytokines TNF alpha may lead to extreme symptoms. That was the hypothesis. Then the mouse model was used and mouse specific Plasmodium was injected into the model system, and what was seen, the mouse had cerebral damage and it died. But when they changed the experiment a little bit, they injected the antibodies to the TNF alpha, the mouse survived. So excessive production of cytokines, specifically TNF alpha, leads to cerebral damage or even death. Now, in endemic areas, children less than 14 years of age, they have very weak immune response. So if the immune response is weak, they are more likely to develop the disease. Adults as well, they do not have complete immunity. So there is always low levels of the Plasmodium in their body. Moving on to the reason why there is always low levels of the disease in people who live in the malarial endemic region for a lifelong period. There are three main reasons. The first is maturational changes. So as I mentioned, the sporozoid has a CS antigen. Now at times during maturation, the structural changes are there in that antigen. So every time the body would think it's a new antigen. So the immune response is not activated. The second is intracellular stage. So when the sporozoids have already entered the liver, it becomes very difficult for the immune system to attack an antigen which is inside its own body part. The third main reason is sporozoid stage. So the mosquito transmits the sporozoids and within 30 minutes, those sporozoids will be going to the liver. In that 30 minute gap, it is very difficult for the body to produce antibodies. Let's assume the body makes the antibody, but the Plasmodium is so clever that it will slough off the CS antigen and it will make the immune system blind because there is no antigen attached to the cell. No antigen, the antibody which is prepared is of no use. That's it for today's video. If you liked my content, please subscribe to my channel. It means a lot to me. Thank you so much for watching. Bye bye.